standing and worship the Lord.
Whatever you are, you can just lift your hands as we worship the Lord. Tell God how good He is. Tell God how awesome He is. He is worthy to be praised. He is worthy to be worshipped. Miracle worker. You are the miracle worker. Come and do a miracle. A miracle today. Come and do.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ. I too welcome you to our service today, the 12th of July 2020. Our readings are Psalms 119, verses 105 through 112, Genesis chapter 25, verses 19 through 34. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through verse 11, and then St. Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through verse 9. Our theme is Hear the Lord. Before we go to hear our sermon, let us pray. Almighty God, in Jesus' name, we do commit ourselves into your hands, that Father, in your mercy, in your grace, you do prepare our hearts so that, Lord, we can hear from you. Speak the very language that each and every one of us is going to hear and to understand. And Lord, what will be difficult for us to understand, may you reveal it so that, Lord, it will help us to know what is exactly in your heart for us, that will help us, Lord, to be drawn more near to you and, Lord, to be enfolded in your love. As, Lord, I begin this sermon, may you use me so that, Lord, I can be a blessing to your people, and also as you bless them, bless me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. In Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 to 9, we see Jesus come out of the house and sat by the seashore. A big crowd of people gathered together to hear him. He entered into a boat, sat, and started teaching them. Jesus used parables to teach them. In all Gospels, apart from St. John, Jesus used that parables, including the one he's using today, to teach the crowd. The word parable comes from the Greek word parabole, which means a placing beside, a cooperation or illustration. The meaning of the dictionary for the word parable is a narrative of imaginary of events used to illustrate a moral or a spiritual teaching. Why did Jesus teach in parables? One, it was a favorable method of the Oriental teaching, as we find in the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 22, verses 1 through 4, the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 1 through 7, and Ezekiel, chapter 17, verses 1 through 24. Two, it was easy to remember because he used familiar scenes from nature to human life. Three, although parables made Jesus' teaching to be easily understood, they also had a hidden meaning that required further explanation. Jesus revealed the hidden meanings to those who were humbly sincere, and hidden to those who were not willing to receive his message. For using parables, the enemies of Jesus could not find any exhibit to use to accuse him. In this text, Jesus used the parable of the sower of the seed to illustrate how people receive the word of God, which is the seed, when it is taught or preached to them by God's messengers, the sowers. In the parable, the first lot of seeds fell on the wayside and eaten by the birds. These are the people who hear the word of God, but their hearts are as hard as the wayside. The wayside was hardened because of being trodden down under the feet of those who walked along it. The seeds did not find render soil where they could enter and germinate, and hence it was eaten by birds, and that means it was taken away by the Satan. The second lot of seeds fell on the stony ground. Here the soil was thin on the rock. Jesus sent it germinated, but when the sun came up, it dried up because the soil was not enough to support the roots of the growing seeds. These are the people who hear the word of God, but because of their hearts are full of other things and little understanding, the word of God dies in their hearts. They found lots of sins, fell among thorns, grew, but shocked by the thorns and dried up. These are the people who receive the word of God, and in their hearts they have a lot of full of things that are ugly, and they keep on pressing them and shocking them, and the word of God doesn't have a space in their hearts. And the fourth, lots of sins fell on the good soil, which was rich, and some produced 100%. Others produced 60%. Others produced 30%. These are the hearts that were full of understanding and were able to retain and share the word of God with others. After that, Jesus ended the parable with these words: "He who hears, let him hear." He and Jesus challenged listeners to hear the Lord. To hear the Lord is our theme of our sermon today. To hear the Lord means listening to the word of God with a firm purpose to obey his command. At this point, my dear listeners, allow me to invite you to accompany me in a spiritual journey that is taking us to the country of the Palestine during the time of Jesus. And there we find Jesus seated at the boat teaching a big crowd. Now, when we have arrived, we have seen a big crowd that was listening to Jesus. People from different towns around Galilee. And the place where the meeting was held is called the Choir of Parables, a natural horse shoe shaped amphitheater. An amphitheater is a round, usually unroofed building with the tiers of seats surrounding a central place. In this place, the voice of Jesus could be heard 300 feet or 90 meters away from where he was sitting in the boat teaching. The crowd that is here is of the Jews and the visitors that were there and living among them. The Jews, from the youngest to the oldest, were all taught the word of God. They knew the law of Moses and they had all the understanding concerning the word of God, and they understood the Old Testament very well. The crowd you see here, they all know the law of Moses. And now the question is this: why is Jesus teaching them in parables? This is because Jesus knew their hearts, and that is why he is teaching in parables. Remember what we said at the beginning, the reason that Jesus taught with the disciples, the reasons that we had that made Jesus teach with the parables. And that is why he has concluded his teaching with these words: "He who has hears, let him hear." Let's now go back to our various places of our boat, and now, with what you have seen and heard, at the core of parables. Now, I ask you, if Jesus comes at our place right now as we talk, what mode of teaching is he going to teach us with? If he looks at our hearts, what does he see in our hearts? Could he see the same things he had seen in the hearts of the Jews and made himself teach them with the parables? Or he would see different things that would lead him teach us with another method that would allow people to understand it straight without hiding some of the teachings? This now depends on what is in your heart and what is in my heart. When Jesus was teaching the Jews, he used six-level understanding, whereby he had to use the sixth number that represents a man. When Jesus looked at their hearts, he could see what they were thinking. He could see their mind was not with him. They had some other arguments in their hearts, and no wonder he decided to teach them by using parables so that those who are able to understand can understand. And to hear the Lord is to listen to the word of God with a firm purpose to obey the command. And that what made St. Peter, with all determination, sought to do a teaching that could help the Christians as well as his heart in Romans chapter 5 through chapter 7. In these chapters, Paul struggled to make Christians understand sin and law. And the more he taught, the more he came to understand his own Christian life. He too found he had some weaknesses as far as sin and law was concerned. In Romans chapter 7, verses 14 to 25, he says, those are the ones that touched his heart and made him change. Verse 14, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sown under sin. For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh. I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. So, I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at my hand. For I delight in the law of God, in my inner being. But I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from the body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, I myself serve the law of God, with my mind, but with my flesh, I serve the law of sin. From this point, Paul offered himself completely to God. In chapter 8, he testifies that he was set free from the law of sin and death by the law of the Spirit of life. He says in Galatians chapter 2, verses 20, that I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ that lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Here, St. Paul brings in two laws we need to understand. One, the law of sin and death. Two, the law of spirit of life. First, let us deal with the law of the sin and death. First, we need to understand the word law. Law is basically that which is laid down, that which is established. It has variety of meanings, but the one common to all is that of order and regularity in the happening of events. In Romans chapter 7, verses 12, Paul writes that the law is holy and the commandment is holy, righteous and good. The law Paul talks about here is the law of Moses. When law came, it revealed sin. This does not mean that the law was not in existence, but by all means it was. This is because the law originates from God. Therefore, through the law, sin entered into the world. And instead of the law giving life, it didn't condemn all what was there because of sin. It is sin that used the law to bring condemnation and death. Law is not to be blamed, but it is holy and righteous and good. As we have seen, law used to be holy, and for an holy end when it was used by sin, which ended in death. So, this is how the law of sin and death came into existence. For the law points out, arouses, and condemns sin. And therefore, the law of sin and death is the controlling power of the sin. To be freed from this law of sin and death, one has to die to sin. How? Before we answer this question, how, let us first understand that no man can be able to die to sin because the sin is in his heart. And as for that reason, the power of sin rules over men. Two, because of this reason, they need a higher power to manage the power of sin. The power of sin came from heaven, so the power to manage sin should too come from heaven. And for that reason, we find God sending his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to come and die and become a man's substitute. When Jesus was crucified on the cross and died and buried and resurrected, he conquered sin. we find Romans 10:6-10, Paul writing, then death in dying to sin once for all. He died for the sake of sinful man. In this way, Jesus submitted to the reign of sin, as it is in Book of Romans, chapter 5, verses 21. It reads, sin reigned in death. The death of Jesus and cut the judicial link between sin and death, and thus he conquered the reign of sin when he resurrected from the dead. For those who hear the Lord, the risen Christ who conquered sin and death on the cross, his wand leads the sinful man to know his sinfulness, and after that he knows how to act obediently and obeys the command of Jesus Christ. Now, because Christ broke a judicial link between sin and death, for man to die to sin, he has three steps to follow. Step number one has to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. It is in the baptism that the sinner enters into union with Christ, because baptism symbolizes the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Number two, refuse sin to reign in one's life. Romans 6, verses 12. It reads, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Number three, one offers his body to God. Romans chapter 6, verses 13. Do not present your bodies to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourself to God as those who have been brought from the dead to life, and your members to God as instruments of righteousness. When a sinful man dies to sin, he dies because he has been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, and his life is hanged in the life of Jesus Christ. The law of sin and death is defeated and set aside by the law of the Spirit of life, and it frees the sinner from the power of the law of sin and death. That one we read from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 and 2. Secondly, now we come to the law of the Spirit of the life. What is the law of the Spirit of the life? The law of the Spirit of the life is the controlling power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who gives life to the new believers who die to sin in Jesus Christ and they are raised from the dead, and then their lives are held in Jesus Christ. In the book of Romans, we find St. Paul using the law in several different ways. He used the law to mean, number one, the controlling power of the Holy Spirit, Romans chapter 8, verses 2. Number two, the law of God, Romans chapter 2, verses 17 to 20, chapter 9, verses 31, and chapter 10, verses 3 to 5. Three, the Old Testament as a whole, Romans 3, chapter 19. Four, the Pentateuch, Romans chapter 3, verses 21b. Number 5, law as principle, Romans 3, verses 20. If put into practice, then our minds, souls, and spirit truly, they say that we have heard the word of God. They say we have understood it. They say we have offered our bodies to God as our God. For it is in those who hear the Lord, whose lives are hid in Jesus Christ, hear the word of the Lord. It is in those who hear the word of the Lord, who struggle as Paul struggled to know the true relationship with God and live to be to the glory of God. It is those who hear the Lord who are content to inherit the kingdom of God through the teachings of Jesus, whereby he has to reveal the hidden secrets that will make the believers stand more firmly in the word of God. It is in those who hear the Lord, together with Saint Paul, they can say confidently that it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that lives in me. It is only those who hear the Lord that can proclaim with certainty that therefore there is no condemnation in my heart, for the law of the life of the spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. Now I am the son of the living God. Now I have offered my body wholly to God, and I belong to God. For I have now been given the inheritance of heaven. Now I have been counted as one who will inherit the everlasting life. My dear listener, you have heard the word of the Lord, and the Lord says, hear the Lord. And those who hear the Lord, they obey. They meditate upon the word of the Lord. They seek the truth as Paul sought the truth until he came to know what is the meaning of the life of sin to death and the life of the spirit of life, so that he could be able to tell Christians how to live a holy life, how to obey the law without being condemned. May the Lord God in Jesus Christ reveal all his secrets in his word that will make you understand the word of God, and the word of God becomes a living being in you and in me for now and forevermore. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word that has taught us how we should struggle to know whether we are living according to your word. We see Paul struggling to understand the law of sin and death and the law of the spirit of life, so that he could know his status. And when he knew how weak he was, he knew when he wanted to do the right thing, he was doing the wrong thing. And then from there he was able to pray and to be strengthened, and he was able to be given power to overcome the spirit of the sin and death and enter into the spirit of the life. Lord, help us to understand your word fully, so that, Lord, it can be our helper at all times, and we overcome all that make us not to be your children. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.